Hello everyone, welcome to Unacademy's YouTube channel. Let me check if the stream is coming up in YouTube or not. After that we will move on to the class. Still, I don't know why the stream has not yet come up in YouTube. Okay, the stream has come up in YouTube, everyone. Listen here everyone, today we are going to have a mini mock test on upcoming prelims examination. Today we'll have a mini mock test on the upcoming prelims examination. So this mock test will be for 1 hour. Okay, so this mock test will be only until 9:30. Okay, so after 9:30 I have another issue that I have to attend to, so I will end this class at 9:30 no matter what. Okay, even if I have some questions pending, I will end this stream at 9:30. Sorry for that. I have another thing I have to attend to at 9:30. Now, before moving on to the class itself, let me give you a brief introduction about myself as well as about Unacademy. See, my name is Aravind. I have completed my BE Mechanical Engineering in 2014 and I have almost 3 years of experience in teaching UPSC Civil Services. And then I have experienced all stages of UPSC Civil Services, that is prelims, mains as well as interview. Now my specialty subjects include subjects like polity, international relations and then current affairs. Now if you wish to know more about my classes, when my classes are about to be conducted, all those things, okay, so please subscribe to my Telegram group unacademy_aravind. Okay, we here I will give you regular updates on when I'm going to conduct my classes, all these things. Not only that, if you have any doubts regarding my classes, you can contact me in this Telegram group. Now, what will you get by subscribing to Unacademy? So, by subscribing to Unacademy, you will get access to daily live classes where you get to watch the classes, you can rewatch them, and also you can ask doubts in those classes. And then, Unacademy will provide you with a live test as well as quizzes. And then, Unacademy also takes courses in a very structured manner. And then, you will get unlimited access to videos concerned with the examination that you are subscribing for. Now, Educationa Tour, you have a weird name. Okay, I'm fine, Educationa. See here, Unacademy is a platform. Okay, it provides where top educators like Mudit Gupta, Roman Saini, Deepanshu Singh, all these top educators, they get to share their knowledge with students who hail from all over India. Okay, so that's what Unacademy does. Okay, as a platform. And then Unacademy covers syllabus in a very comprehensive manner. Okay, so every nook and corner of UPSC syllabus will be covered by Unacademy. Not only that, the same syllabus will be covered by multiple faculties, so that you get to choose your faculty based on your liking. Now I suggest you guys download the Unacademy learning app so that you can keep a better track of your learning goals, how much time you're spending in Unacademy for learning, all those things. Okay, so download Unacademy learning app. Here, if your favorite teacher is about to take a class in Unacademy, you will get immediate notification in your app. Now, these are the amounts charged by Unacademy for PLUS platform. These are very, very less compared to offline institutions where they will be charging upwards of 4 to 5 lakh rupees. Okay, this amount will include fees like fees, rent, food. Okay, not only with Unacademy, you are learning from the comfort of your home, you'll be saving a lot on fees also. Okay, because the upfront cost in Unacademy is very, very less. Now, on top of very meager sum that Unacademy charges you, if you are using my code ARAVINDV, you will get 10% as offer. Okay, so don't forget to use my code ARAVINDV in case you wish to get offer of 10%. Okay, so even with Iconic subscription, where you'll get additional benefits like assignment of personal coach, daily mains question and answer practice, study planner, as well as personalized feedback. Even here, if you're using my code ARAVINDV, you will get 10% as offer. Now let's move on to today's mock test. Now today's mock test is a general mock test. Okay, it will have questions from all subjects. Okay, so I'll give you 80 seconds. I will give you 80 seconds to answer each questions. Okay. And please give your answer in the live chat section. Okay, this is the first question. Now please give your answer. Now please give your answer, everyone. Please give your answer. Hemant, your given answer is A. Anyone else, please give your answer. Okay, time's up, everyone. See, the answer for this question is C. The answer for this question is C, both 1 and 2. Now, what is the meaning of elasticity of demand? As the price of a commodity drops, okay, the demand for a particular commodity will increase. That is called as elasticity of demand. Okay, so now this cross elasticity of demand, it measures the relative change in demand of a commodity due to change in price level of related commodity. Yes, this is correct. Okay, now the next statement says that it is always positive for substitute goods. This is correct. Now what is substitute goods? For example, I'll give you one scenario. For example, the price of Nike shoes is rising. Now, since the price of Nike shoes are rising, okay, there is a substitute good called as Adidas shoes. Now, since the price of Nike shoes has risen, but Adidas has not changed their price level. Since Nike has increased their prices, what will happen to the demand of Adidas shoes? Adidas shoes demand will increase. Okay, Adidas shoes demand will increase. Okay, so the price of Nike, as a result of price hike in Nike shoes, the Adidas shoes demand will increase. That is the meaning of being positive for substitute goods. In this scenario, Adidas will be called as substitute goods, not Nike. So the answer for this question is C, both 1 and 2. Now, the cross elasticity of demand in an economic concept that measures the responsiveness in the quantity of demand of one good when the price for another good changes. Also, cross price elasticity of demand, this measurement is calculated by taking the percentage change in quantity demanded of one good and be dividing it by percentage good in the price of other good. Okay, now this is also a measure of relative change in the quantity demanded of a commodity due to a change in its price for substitute and or complement. Hence, statement 1 is correct. Now, the cross elasticity of demand for substitute goods is always positive because the demand for one good increases when the price for substitute good increases. Now, when goods are substituted for each other, then cross elasticity of demand is positive. In other words, when the price of Y leads to an increase in demand for X, for instance, with increase in price of tea, demand for coffee will increase as coffee is substituted for tea. Hence, statement 2 is also correct. Now, alternatively, the cross elasticity of demand for complementary goods is negative. In case of complementary goods, cross elasticity of demand is negative. A proportionate increase in price of one commodity will lead to a proportionate fall in demand of another commodity also, because both are being demanded jointly. Okay, for example, if the price of coffee increases, the quantity demanded of coffee sticks drops as consumers are drinking a lot less coffee and they need to purchase fewer sticks. Now, cross elasticity is zero if a change in price of one commodity will not affect the quantity demanded of another commodity. In this case, goods which are not related to each other, the cross elasticity of demand will be zero. Now, please give your answer for the next question, everyone. Okay, time's up, everyone. See, the answer for this question is B. The answer for this question is B, 2 and 3 only. The first statement is wrong. Why? Because it is an independent organization, not an organ of IEA. Okay, it is an independent organization. It does not belong to IAEA. So, this is, first statement is wrong. Other two statements are correct. Okay. Now, the International Panel on Fissile Materials was founded in January of 2006. And is an independent group of arms control and non-proliferation experts from both nuclear weapon as well as non-nuclear weapon states. Okay, so in statement one is not correct because it is a independent organization. Now, the mission of IPFM is to analyze the technical basis for practical and achievable policy initiatives to secure, consolidate and reduce stockpiles, both military as well as civil, of highly enriched uranium as well as plutonium. Now, these fissile materials are key ingredients in nuclear weapons, and their control is critical to nuclear weapons disarmament, to halting proliferation of nuclear weapons. Okay, so we have to control enriched uranium, and also to ensure terrorists do not acquire nuclear weapons, we have to cut short the production of enriched uranium. So, statement 2 is correct. Now, the members of IPFM include members like Brazil, Canada, China, France, Germany, India, Iran, Japan, Mexico, Norway, Pakistan, South Korea, Russia, South Africa, Sweden, the United Kingdom and the United States. Now, this group of countries includes 7 nuclear weapon states and 10 non-weapon states. IPFM research and reports are shared with international organizations, national governments and non-governmental groups. Hence, statement 3 is also correct. Now, please give your answer for the next question, everyone. Please give your answer for the next question. Okay, times up everyone. See, the answer for this question is D. The answer for this question is D. All these benefits are correct with regards to internationalization of rupee. Now, currency internationalization is a widespread use of currency outside the borders of country of issue. Now, the level of currency internationalization for a currency is determined by demand that other countries have for that particular currency. Okay, see, if currently there are number of currencies that are internationalized, like US dollar, euro, Japan yen. All these currencies are internationalized because other countries, they demand these currencies. Okay, so this the based on that demand only we will determine the level of currency internationalization. Now, such currencies which have high degree of internationalization will also tend to be held as reserve currencies. Why? Because these currencies will be used in case of trade. Now, internationalization of rupee will facilitate a greater degree of freedom of integration of Indian economy with the rest of the world in terms of foreign trade and international capital flows. Now, there are a number of benefits to a country whose currency is internationalized. Now, it provides more certainty to residents who can denominate foreign transactions in their home currencies. Now, they can also borrow in foreign markets without incurring exchange rate risk, potentially enabling them to find cheaper funding. Okay, all of you have given the wrong answer, everyone. Sorry for that. Now, other key benefits of internationalization of rupee include savings on foreign exchange transactions for Indian residents, reduced foreign exchange exposure for Indian corporate, reduction in dependence on foreign exchange reserves for the balance of payment liquid stability. In general, the internationalization of rupee creates an underpinned demand for the currency, which should dampen the interest rates and help lower the domestic cost of capital. Hence, all the statements are correct. Kungunattu Samayal and Medicine. Hi, Kungunattu Samayal and Medicine. Do you have a channel, Kungunattu Samayal and Medicine? Okay. Kungunattu Samayal and Medicine. Okay, time's up everyone, time's up. See, the answer for this question is C2 only. The answer for this question is C2 only. Now, the concept of separate electorates was abolished right from Wavell plan itself. It was abolished right from Wavell plan itself. Okay, so this is wrong. Now, formation of new Muslim majority provinces by bifurcating Punjab and Bengal. This is wrong. Now, Dronadulla Ishwar, you are given the correct answer. Okay, Renuga and Hemant Mangala, you have given the wrong answer. Okay, so the answer for this question is C2 only. This one is correct. 1/3 representation of Muslims in Central Legislative Assembly. Now, earlier in December of 1927, a large number of Muslim leaders had met at Delhi at Muslim League session and evolved 4 proposals for their demands to be incorporated into the draft constitution. Now, these proposals, which were accepted by the Madras session of Congress, came to be known as Delhi proposals. These were joint electorates in place of separate electorates with reserved seats for Muslim. Hence, statement 1 is not correct. 1/3 representation of Muslims in Central Legislative Assembly. Hence, statement 2 is correct. Representation to Muslims in Punjab and Bengal, proportion to their population. Hence, statement 3 is not correct. Okay, did not advocate for bifurcation. Now, formation of 3 new Muslim majority provinces like Sindh, Baluchistan, Northwest Frontier provinces, this was also one of the demand. Okay, so these are termed as Delhi proposals. Now, please give your answer for the next question, everyone. Okay, Hemant Vangala and Renuka Pillai, you guys have given the correct answer. The answer for this question is C, both 1 and 2. The answer for this question is C, both 1 and 2. Now, recently, Niti Aayog presented India's second voluntary national review at United Nations High Level Political Forum on Sustainable Development 2020. Now, statement 1 is correct. Why? Because the High Level Political Forum on Sustainable Development is a main UN platform on sustainable development. It has a central role in the follow-up and review of implementation of 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development. Now, in 2015, the United Nations General Assembly adopted 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development. 193 member countries, including India, got committed to 17 sustainable development goals that require effort to end all forms of poverty, inequalities, tackling climate change while ensuring that no one was left behind. Now, statement 2 is also correct. Why? Because the High Level Committee on Sustainable Development Goals meets annually in July for 8 days under the auspices of Economic and Social Council of UN. Now, the VNRs presented by member states at HLPF are critical component of review of progress of implementation of agenda and SDGs. Now, the reviews are voluntary and state-led and are aimed at facilitating sharing of experiences, including successes, challenges and lessons learned. Now, Niti Aayog prepared and presented India's first VNR at 2017. Now, please give your answer for the next question, everyone. Now, if you attended my emergency class, you can easily answer this question. If you guys have attended my emergency class, you can easily answer this question. Raju Ratto, you can answer C, B, okay, all of you guys are wrong. Okay, all of you guys are wrong. The actual answer for this question is A1 only. Okay, the actual answer for this question is A1 only. First statement is correct, second statement is wrong. See, I will explain why. See here, according to Article 356, President, he can impose, President by means of a presidential order, he can impose state emergency. We can impose state emergency. Now, once a state emergency has been imposed, state executive will be dissolved. What is the meaning of state executive? Chief minister plus council of ministers will be dissolved. Now, state legislature, it can either be suspended or dissolved. It can either be suspended or dissolved. Am I being clear? It can either be suspended or dissolved. Okay, now since state legislature is not functioning, okay, someone has to pass laws regarding state legislature is not functioning, right? So someone has to pass budget, some laws required for that particular state. So what will do, what happens is that president will delegate the powers of state legislature to parliament. Okay, president will delegate the powers of state legislature to parliament. Okay, so first statement is correct. Now, if you look at the life of state emergency, once the second house has given their approval, the life of state emergency will continue for another 6 months. Okay, it will continue for another 6 months. Now, upon subsequent parliamentary approval, The state emergency can be extended for another 6 months. State emergency can be extended for another 6 months. Similarly, it can be extended up to 3 years. It can be extended up to 3 years. Okay. So if you look at the statement, what does it say? Extend the president rule indefinitely with the approval of parliament every 6 months. That is wrong. Why? Because it can be extended only up to a maximum of 3 years. Okay. So that is wrong. Now please give your answer for the next question, everyone. Please give your answer for the next question, everyone. See, everyone has given the wrong answer, okay, except Dronadulla Ishwar. Ishwar has given the correct answer. The answer for this question is B, 2 only. Now, most of you have given answer as D. See here, what is the question here? Which of the following factors can increase the resistance of an ecosystem against foreign invasion? What is the meaning of foreign species invasion? A species from other ecosystem invading into that particular ecosystem. Now, if available resources are very high in a particular ecosystem, what will happen? It will create a natural environment where other species can come in, and then they can utilize that resources and it can invade that particular ecosystem. Okay, so resources availability should always be at optimum level. It should not be either higher or lower. Okay, now forest fires. If forest fires happens, what will happen? The entire ecosystem will be destroyed. Most of the ecosystem will be destroyed. Since most of the ecosystem will be actually destroyed, some new plants will be introduced into this area. Clear? Because the required nutrients have been depleted completely. Okay, so this is not correct. This is not correct. This one is correct. Okay, so the answer for this question is B, 2 only. Now, ecological invasion refers to the process by which some particular species which are better adapted to a given environment than are its existing inhabitants or activities enter and eventually dominate an ecosystem. Now, some of the factors which impact the resistance to invasion are discussed below. Now, resistance to invasion decreases when resource availability is higher than resource uptake. Now, leaving the resources of invading species plan to utilize. Okay, see this excess resources will be utilized by invading plants. Okay, now thus ecosystem subject to prolonged fluctuations of resource supply may be more susceptible to invasion than systems with stable resource supply. It is known as fluctuating resource hypothesis, hence option one is not correct. Now, native community connectivity may increase biotic resistance to invasion by enhancing species richness and evenness. Communities with higher species richness have higher productivity, thus provide more resource competition. Okay, since there is high level of competition, okay, other species cannot enter into this ecosystem and they cannot get resources. Okay, so option two is correct. Now, extrinsic factors such as disturbances like forest fires can increase the probability of successful invasion through several mechanisms. Disturbances may decrease native species abundances, decrease species diversity, or change community composition. Now, native species richness can significantly decrease with disturbance presence, while invader abundance and richness can significantly increase with increasing disturbance. Hence, option 3 is not correct. Now, please give your answer for the next question, everyone. Okay, I believe I have repeated this question. I have asked this question in my last test itself. Okay, nonetheless, most of you guys are new for this test, except Neelam, I believe. Yeah, so please give your answer for this question, everyone. Neelam, you have attended the previous class, so I know you know the answer. Okay. Pingdis, ஒரு ஹெல்ப் போட்டு சும்மா தண்ணி மட்டும் தெரியும். Okay, time's up, guys. See, the answer for this question is C, mandamus, q warranto, and prohibition. Okay, Renuga has given the correct answer. Raju Ratho, you can the wrong answer. The answer is C, not D. Now, this is mandamus. Okay, mandamus writ petition will be used in the scenario. Here, q warranto will be used. Here, the writ of prohibition will be used. Okay, now let's look at individual writ jurisdiction. Now, in case of habeas corpus, the writ of habeas corpus is an effective bulwark of personal liberty. Now, this writ is a remedy available to a person who is confined without legal justification. Now, the words of habeas corpus literally mean to have the body. Now, if you look at the next writ, mandamus, the word mandamus literally means we command. Now, the writ of mandamus is a command issued to direct any person, corporation, inferior court or government, requiring him to do a particular thing specified which within pertains of his office and is further in the nature of public duty. And also implementation of National Food Security Act is the duty of the government. So in the second case, the writ of mandamus is likely to be issued. Okay, now in case of prohibition, if an inferior court is acting beyond its means, if inferior court is acting beyond their jurisdiction or violating the rules of constitution or parliamentary law, in that case, High Court or Supreme Court will use the writ of prohibition to curtail the powers of inferior court. Okay. Now, in case of prohibition, prohibition writ will be used before the actual occurrence of case. Okay. Before the case has happened itself, prohibition will be used. But in case of certiorari, after the case has concluded, the writ of certiorari will be used. Okay. So, prohibition is preventive. Certiorari is curative. Now, if you look at quo warranto, now the writ of quo warranto enables enquiry into legality of the claim which a person asserts to an office or franchise and to oust that person from such position if he is considered as an usurper. Now, this writ is issued when the office of public and of substantial nature created by statute of constitution itself, the respondent has asserted his claim to the office. Now, quo warranto can be issued even though he has not assumed the office. In the second case, writ of quo warranto will be likely issued. Hence, option C is the correct answer. Now, please give your answer for the next question, everyone. Okay, see, the answer for this question is D. The answer for this question is D. See, according to Allais effect, if a population of a species falls below a particular population, okay, if the population of a species falls below a particular limit, the individual fitness of that particular species will decrease as a result of that. Now, this might lead to extinction. Okay, so for example, dolphins, okay, gangetic dolphins. So, if the population of gangetic dolphins is decreasing beyond a certain threshold, if the population is decreasing beyond a certain threshold, now the individual fitness of this dolphin species will also decrease, which may lead to extinction. Okay, now that's what they are trying to say here. There is a positive association between the absolute average fitness level and population size over a finite interval. Such positive association may or may not necessarily give rise to critical population size below which population cannot persist. Now, Allais effects are broadly defined as declining individual fitness as at low population size or density that can result in critical population thresholds below which population crash to extinction. Now, there are a variety of mechanisms that can create Allais effects, including mating systems, predation, environmental modification, and social interactions, among others. As such, they are very relevant to many conservation programs where scientists and managers are often working with populations that have been reduced to low densities or small numbers. Okay, now this is not needed for you. Okay, now this is not needed for you. Now let's move on to the next question. People, I'm going to end this class at 9:20. Okay, I have another important thing that I have to attend to, so I will end this session at 9:20, no matter what. Okay, so sorry for that. Okay, so I still have only completed only 40% of the questions today, but nonetheless, I'm going to end it because I have another important thing that I have to attend today. Hemant, you are given the correct answer. The answer is C. Okay. Hemant has given the correct answer. The answer is C. Okay. See, the answer for this question is C. All these statements are correct. Now, if you look at Ishbaku dynasty, it was a feudatory tribe under the patronage of great Satavahana empire that ruled the Andhra region. Now, the delta of Krishna and Godavari rivers on the eastern coast. Now, their capital was the city of Vijayapuri, or also known as Nagarjuna Kunda, hence statement 1 and 2 are correct. Now, the downfall of Satavahanas around 3rd century CE due to internal skirmishes of its feudatories, the Abiras, Traikutas, Brahmapalians, Salankayanas, in order to gain power and internal confusion rising due to such circumstances, strengthened the hold of Ishvakus. Now, Amaravati school of art flourished in the region of Andhra Pradesh between the lower valleys of Krishna and Godavari. Now, the main patterns of this art forms were Satavahanas, but it was carried out even later, patronized by the successive Ishvaku rulers. Now, this art is said to have flourished between 150 BC to 350 AD. And this statement 3 is also correct. Now, please give your answer for the next question, everyone. Okay, time is up, everyone. Okay, Srikanth and Neelam, you guys have given the correct answer. The answer for this question is Buddha. Okay, so see here, look at the question. Mongolian Khanjur. Okay, the name itself is there, Mongolian. Okay, so it can either be Buddha or Confucius. Now, Confucius, does he have any association with India? Does he have any association with India? No, right? So, the answer must be logically Buddha. Okay, now Srikanth and Neelam has given the correct answer, and the rest of you guys have given the wrong answer. Now, the Ministry of Culture has taken up the project under National Mission for Manuscripts of free printing of almost 108 volumes of Mongolian Khanjur. Now, it is expected that all Mongolian Khanjur 108 volumes will be published by March of 2022. Now, Mongolian Khanjur is a Buddhist canonical text which is considered to be a most important religious text in Mongolia. Now, Khanjur is a Mongolian language which means that concise orders. That is the words of Lord Buddha in particular. The language of Khanjur is classical Mongolian, and there are around 108 volumes of this Mongolian Khanjur. Now, it is held in high esteem by Mongolian Buddhists, and that they worship the Khanjur at temples and they recite the lines of Khanjur in their daily life or a part of their lifestyle as a sacred ritual. Almost in every monastery in Mongolia, the Khanjur are kept. Let us tell you that Mongolian Khanjur has been translated from Tibetan. In fact, Mongolian Khanjur is a source of providing cultural identity to Mongolia. Now, please give your answer for the next question, everyone. Please give your answer for the next question. Okay, guys, I believe the time is up. Okay, Okay, so the answer for this question is the C, World Economic Forum. Okay, Neelam, you are correct. Okay, the answer is World Economic Forum. Now, 1 Trillion Trees Initiative or 1T.org is a World Economic Forum initiative designed to support UN Decade on Ecosystem Restoration to the year of 2021 to 2030. Led by UNEP as well as FAO. Now, 1trillion.org exists to correct, empower and mobilize a global reforestation community of millions, unleashing their potential to act as an unprecedented scale and speed to ensure conservation and restoration of 1 trillion trees within this decade. Now, please give your answer for the next question, everyone. Please give your answer for the next question. Now, this is the last question that we are going to look today, everyone. This is the last question that we are going to discuss today. After that, I am going to end this class. Okay, see, the answer for this question is D. You know, the answer for this question is D. Gopal Hari Deshmukh. Okay. Now, Gopal Hari Deshmukh was a social reformer as well as a rationalist from the state of Maharashtra. Now, he held the post of judge of under British Raj, but wrote for weekly Prabhakar under the pen name of Lokahitavadi on social reform issues. Now, he advocated a reconsideration of Indian society on rational principles as well as modern humanistic and secular values. Now, this person attacked Hindu orthodoxy and supported social as well as religious equality. He wrote against the evils of caste system. Okay. In his weekly, he said that if religion does not sanction social reform, then change the religion. He started a weekly called as Hitechu and played a leading role in the foundation of periodicals such as Gyan Prakash, Hindu Prakash and Lokahitavadi. Hence, option D is the correct answer. Now, if you look at other famous personalities like Bal Shastri Jambedkar, he was also known as father of Marathi journalism for his efforts in starting journalism in Marathi language with the first newspaper in the language called as Darpan. He wanted to build a society having scientific outlook. He was one of those social activists who made continuous efforts in generating useful and health consciousness among common masses and attempted to educate uneducated people. Now, Jyotirao Govindarao Phule was an Indian social activist, thinker and anti-caste social reformer and writer for Maharashtra. His work extended to many fields including eradication of untouchability and caste system and women's emancipation. Now, he is mostly known for his efforts educating women and lower caste people. Now, if you look at Gopalakrishna Gokhale, he was an Indian liberal political leader and a social reformer during the Indian independence movement. Now, Gokhale was senior leader of Indian National Congress and the founder of Servants of India Society. Okay, so that's it, everyone. Okay, that's it, everyone. That's it, everyone. Okay, if you have any doubt so far, let's discuss this one last question. Okay, this one last question, please give your answer. For this last question, please give your answer. After that, I will end the session. Now, guys, please give your answer. No one is giving the answer. I don't know why. Okay. Time's up, everyone. Srikanth, you have given the correct answer. The answer is Narkundam Hornbill. Okay, so the answer is Narkundam Hornbill. Okay, so that's it, everyone, for today's class. Okay, so if you have any doubts so far, I will give you 1 to 2 minutes to ask your doubts. After that, I am going to end the stream. I'll give you 1 to 2 minutes to ask your doubts or regarding this class or any other class. After that, I am going to end the stream. Please ask your doubts. Okay. Please ask your doubts, people. You are too late, Swaranarjan. Okay, the mock test has been finished. Okay, please ask your doubts if you have any. Here, okay, if you look at environment, You have to analyze what type of questions are being asked from environment. Okay. What kind of questions are being asked in environment? Okay. Most of the environment questions are getting combined with geography. Most of the environment questions are getting combined with geography. Like, for example, they will ask questions like, arrange this following, okay, match the following national geographical box with their corresponding vegetation. Okay, so they are combining environment with geography. So that part is very important. Agriculture, okay, agriculture part is very important. Any emerging agriculture technologies like monocropping, multi-cropping, sericulture, aquaculture, aquaponics, all these things are there, right? Okay, so all these things, agriculture technology is very important. Apart from them, topics like pollution is very important. Okay, and then apart from that, environment legislations like environment impact assessment. It is the current issue, right? So a question can be asked using environment impact assessment. Solid Waste Management Bill of 2016, Municipal Waste Management Bill of 2016, E-Waste Management Bill of 2013. Okay, so there are certain environment legislations. Wildlife Protection Act of 1972. Okay, Environment Protection Act of 1986. So there are certain environment protection, environment legislation which are important for the prelims examination. So that's what environment is all about, everyone. Okay. Apart from species, all those things, these are the things that you have to learn from environment. Now, most of the people, they will learn national park species, all those things, most of them they will learn, but these are the additional things that you have to learn. Okay, everyone, any other doubts? Okay, I'm hard pressed for time. Okay, sorry for that. I'm going to end this stream. Okay. Goodbye, everyone. Have a wonderful day. See you tomorrow. Okay. Tomorrow, I don't have any class. Okay. I'm going out. Tomorrow, I don't have any class. Okay.